moon or something, you know, because they're round. Look at them. But I'll have everybody look at them. She brought them because this represents a miracle. She couldn't even walk, but she went ahead and walked anyhow. They said they don't know how she was walking, but she was walking. Amen. So God is good, isn't he? Everybody that loves God, say praise the Lord. Lift your hand up and let's just praise God for a moment. Hallelujah. Lord, we praise your name. We praise your name. We praise your name today, Lord. Little testimony today. My friend Mike Murdoch wrote this song after I said something to him at a camp meeting.
Over the years, I've tasted the tears of plans that somehow went wrong. I've been weary of struggle, and I've knelt in the rubble, and I've cried from my heart, Lord, how long? Oh, but then his hand reached down, and on my lips he placed a cup, and the taste of his love was very sweet. And ever since that night, everything's been all right, 'cause I'm still in love with Jesus.
Anybody still love him? Sing it. I'm still in love with Jesus. Yes, I am. And I'll never change my mind. In those lonely hours, well, he's always time, and I'm still in love with Jesus. Raise your hand and say, I'll never change my mind, because he's never changed. Through the years, he's been the same, and I'm still in love with Jesus. In everybody's life, there's always things that we don't plan for. Things happen, financial setbacks that can absolutely, totally destroy us and bring us down. Sometimes it's just sickness that won't go away. It lingers on. I've been afflicted by losing many friendships down through the years. Sometimes people have told me that divorce has just left them totally devastated. Loneliness has overwhelmed them. Sometimes you'll wonder if you ever will love again. But there's one thing I know today. When your back is up against the wall and there seems to be no one left to care, I want to remind you that you have one friend. One friend named Jesus. And Lord, he never changes. He never changes his mind. He'll always love you. And that's why that I'm still in love with Jesus. Come on, sing it if you know it. I'm still in love with Jesus. And he's never changed in those lonely hours. Well, he's always on time. And I'm still in love with Jesus. Yes, I am. And I'll never change my mind.
because he's never changed, and through the years he's been the same, and I'm still in love with Jesus. I'm still in love with Jesus.
Everybody say amen if you still are in love with Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm going to get a bigger pulpit down here. I use this because it's mobile, because I can roll it and go anywhere. Can't get away from the word. If you back there, I'll just roll it right back to you. Hallelujah. Can't get away. God has always revealed himself, hasn't he, to his people in many generations. My scripture today is actually in Isaiah, the 60th chapter, the very first verse. Because I know today there's going to be a lot of sermons preached about how discouraged we should be. But I'm going to tell you, I don't know what everybody's so excited about. You knew it was happening all along. What, are you going to hide now? Within a mile from here, there's probably places that you can go there and do whatever you want to. And so you say you're upset about something, a Supreme Court ruling. I'm not. Doesn't bother me. I'm going to keep my wife. I encourage you, if you're married, continue to be married. Amen. And I mean, that doesn't change me. They passed laws legalizing marijuana, but I didn't go get any. Amen. What I'd like to say is, all you preachers been hiding undercover. You've been gay in the church. You singers that have been gay, you now you can come out. Just tell everybody. That way mama and papa won't have to send you no more money and wonder what you doing with it. Like you was fooling us all along. Like we didn't know. So now you might as well just come on out and tell everybody. Amen. It's legal, I guess. Somebody say amen. That don't make it right, but it's legal. Amen. And if it's legal, I do obey the laws of the land, and I encourage everybody to do the same thing. However, I'm not going to get in the pig pen with the prodigal son to try to get him to be saved. Amen. I'm going to tell him to come on out and let's go to the Father's house. Amen. Can anybody say amen to that? Amen. Word of God says, rise and shine, for thy light is come. I'm not preaching on darkness today. I'm preaching on light. And the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people. But the Lord shall arise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee. So that's a promise for us here today. The world may be covered with darkness, but just let it alone. Amen. Don't touch it. Taste not, touch not, handle not the unclean thing, and I'll receive you, is what the Word of God says. And that's what we're going to do. We're going to keep on living a consistent Christian life according to the Word of God. Amen. That's my freedom in America. Amen. Amen. And we're free to do that. You're free not even to come to church on the 5th of July. As a lot of people have chosen to do. They'd rather have barbecue than come to see the house of God. Hallelujah. Yes. And that's all right. But that did that stop me from coming? No. Did it stop you from coming? No. What everybody else does, did that stop you in any way? No. No, you continue to serve God. You know, the Old Testament covenant of God, in Old Testament times, did you know that God actually moved through things that were in nature, so to speak, natural things? They were made manifest. God manifested himself like in the burning bush. God revealed himself in a cloud by day and a fire by night. He became a rock in the desert and hid himself in the rod of Moses. In the Old Testament, God revealed his conceptions and ideas and truths and knowledge, but not always through men, But God began to choose men to reveal his word to this world. God anointed prophets. He came up with an idea called the elect of God. People that were chosen and selected and appointed and separated from the rest of the world. God has always had a man. God has always had a woman who was going to be obedient to his will. Some of them became voices crying in the wilderness. Some of them lost their heads. They were beheaded because of what they believed. Some were crucified because of what they believed. But I'm going to tell you now, in this last day, the last day in time, God is going to reveal his covenant to his people again. The anointing of God is going to cover this whole earth, regardless of the darkness. Everybody might not see this light, but God is going to bring light to this world. Everybody won't see it. Some people sit in darkness and they love the darkness because their deeds are evil, the word of God says. But I love the light. I came out of the darkness and I'm in the light today. God's covenant in the ark could be carried by four men, and all of this has been changed. The treasures of God today are not in the ark of the covenant. We don't even know where it is. The treasure of God today is inside vessels of clay. Yes. The power of God lives in earthly temples. Yes. It lives inside us. The kingdom of God is within flesh and bone and blood bodies. It's in us. The kingdom of God, the Spirit of God, through the Spirit of God, is poured out on the inside of us. It's in us, God's people today. If anybody wants to see God, stop looking at the blood moon and the sunsets. Stop looking at all of these signs in nature, because God doesn't appear there anymore. If you want to know, if you want to see God, you have to come and look at God's people. That's where God is. God is in his people. God is in his holy temple. You have to look at God's people to see God, or else you're going to see signs and wonders and odd looking things. This world is full of natural wonders, but God's not in them. Elijah went up on the mountain to find God, and when he got up there, the Bible says that God went by. God went by in a strong wind. God went by in a fire, but God wasn't in the wind and God wasn't in the fire. God came to him in a still small voice. It doesn't mean God has to speak in a still small voice every time, but I'm going to tell you, stop looking at these things in nature. We've got a charismatic world out here that has gone crazy about the color of the moon. And I'm sorry right now, that's straight out of Kabbalah. That has absolutely nothing to do with this Bible that I have in my hand. You looking to the moon for a sign? The moon is going to tell us when Jesus comes back? Give me a break. The Word of God tells us when Jesus is coming back. Is anybody going to say amen? I went over on Mount Sinai. I didn't see no burning bush. You want to know why? God doesn't appear in burning bushes anymore. Amen. How you like them apples? Hallelujah. I went on top of the mountain there in Jerusalem. There's a pagan Muslim temple there now. The temple of God is long gone. And so I didn't go there looking for God. I went to look out of curiosity. I didn't go there to find God. Can anybody say amen? I want to go. I'd like to take a tour to the Holy Land to show you all of these places. But when you get over there, if you don't take God with you, you ain't going to find him there. Amen. Can anybody say amen? Amen. No matter where you go, there's only one place that God abides, where God lives, and that's right in here. Yes. Can anybody say amen? You say, well, I didn't see that. I can't see that. Well, you need to open some spiritual eyes. God lives inside us. This is where God lives. God lived in Jesus. The Spirit of God was in Jesus. God was in Jesus walking on the water. God was in Jesus opening blind eyes. God was in Jesus healing the sick. God was in Jesus making the lame to walk. God was in Jesus multiplying loaves and fishes. God was in Jesus in the boat calming the storm. God was in Jesus, hallelujah, when he cleansed the impure woman. God was in Jesus cleansing the lepers. God was in Jesus. And then Jesus turned around and made an amazing statement. I wish everybody in this world would hear it, because y'all wandering around looking for another prophet. You're looking for somebody to heal you, somebody to cast the devil out of you, when you don't know that the healer is right in here, that the blesser is right in here, the anointing is right in here. God lives in here. I don't have to reach outside. I don't have to reach up toward the moon or the sun and the stars. I'm going to tell you, God's not up there keeping Jupiter and Mars from running into each other. Hallelujah. God lives in here. Jesus in that temple in the synagogue in Capernaum one day was standing there, and they brought him the letter of the law to read, or the prophet, and he read it and said, "Behold, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because God has anointed me." You know, it didn't sound like them dead readers of Scripture. Every once in a while, well, we have somebody show up here wants to read. That's how they read the Scripture, like it's dead. When I read the Bible, it's about me. I read the Bible with myself in mind. I don't do no vain repetition here. Hallelujah. You come to this church, you're going to have to get a little fire built on the inside of you. Come on, say amen. When that fire gets started on the inside of you, then you get healed, then you get blessed, then you get prospered, then you get anointing, then you get a better car, you get a bigger house, you get more money, you dress better, you wear jewelries. Hallelujah. The very minute when you get God on the inside of you, everything around you changes. You don't care about, well, they didn't give me a bridge. Well, you don't care about a bridge card. God is your supply. God is your way. Well, they didn't move me into that house. Well, so what? God has a house for you. Who told you you had to make payments on it? Who told you you had to make payments on a car? You know, this is all lies in this world that everybody believes. Come on, church. You need to say amen here. Isn't your God big enough to just give you a house? Isn't your God big enough to give you a diamond ring? Isn't your God big enough to give you a Mercedes Benz? Isn't your God big enough to give you a brand new Lincoln car? Hallelujah. Somebody shout amen. God can do that for you, can't he? Isn't your God big enough? And if he puts this treasure on the inside of you, you will never go hungry. Your seed will never beg bread. You will never be without any good thing. I will withhold no good thing from them who walk uprightly before me. You say, oh, the devil's fight. Who cares? Devil's always going to fight. Well, I got sickness. Yeah, I know. Get rid of it. Get loosed of it. Tell it to go. I'm talking to you about the power of God on the inside of you. Miracles are in the kingdom of heaven. I'm in the kingdom of heaven. Healing is in the kingdom of God. Tongues are in the kingdom. Interpretation, power to move forward is in God. Power to cast out devils. The kingdom of God is on the inside of you. It comes without observation, meaning that nobody can see it. Jesus said the kingdom of God cometh without observation. You need to see. Observation means you don't see it. You don't notice it. And the kingdom of God came into the world when Jesus stood up on top of that mountain. And St. Peter said, I was an eyewitness of the glory and the majesty and the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. He saw the power of God enter into a man's body. He saw the power of God, the resurrection power of God, the living power of God. There appeared with him Moses and Elijah. But both Moses and Elijah disappeared, and a voice came out of that cloud. Peter said, I heard it, I saw it. Voice came out of that cloud and said, this is my beloved son, hear him. You know something? What happened to Moses and what happened to Elijah? I know what happened to them. Moses stepped inside Jesus. Elijah stepped inside Jesus. He was a fulfillment of all the law and the fulfillment of all the prophets. When he came down the mountain, he said, don't tell this to anybody. Don't let anybody know this, because see, this is an invisible kingdom. Hallelujah. You haven't caught a hold of that yet. You think the kingdom is in a building over here that has a tall tower and a big window in it. That's not the kingdom of God. That's a building. I don't even know if God lives in those buildings. I'm not trying to get God to move into Deeper Life Church here, the Roseville Theater. Hallelujah. When I walked in here, God moved in here. Somebody say amen. When you walked in here, didn't you bring Jesus with you? Hallelujah. I'm not trying to anoint the building. I don't care about these sticks and stones and hay and stubble. I'm not building on the building. I'm building you. Hallelujah. I want you to be strong in God. I want you to be full of the faith and the power of God. Hallelujah. I want when the devil comes to you, don't bug me at 3 a.m. in the morning. Stand up there and hold your hand up and say, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, Satan, the Lord rebuke you. Hallelujah. You have this power. The kingdom of God is in you. Hallelujah. Forgiving is in your nature. Loving is in your nature. You are ordained with God's plan. God has his plan working on the inside of you. God had a plan for you before he made the flora and the fauna. Before there was animals and plants, God already had a plan for you. You have the power of creation living on the inside of you. It's right now available to you. The power of creation. The power to speak the word. The power to call those things that are not as though they are. You have that power. You have the keys of God. Hallelujah. You have the keys of health and faith and the anointing and the Holy Ghost. Jesus said, I have the keys of the kingdom. You're endowed today. You're filled. You're endowed. It's a gift to you, an endowment, an entitlement. You have godly power living on the inside of you. You have Christ-like power living on the inside of you. Not only do you have the meekness of a lamb, you also have the boldness of a lion living on the inside of you. You are God's rod to roll back the waters. You're God's burning bush to speak to this world. You're a flame of fire that God sends into this world to let power of the Holy Ghost be seen in this world. We've been too quiet, church. We have been too quiet. We've sat here and let all the Christ haters and the abominable and the hatred-filled people in this world stand up while we were sitting here trying to be meek, trying to be humble, trying to be Christ-like. Can I tell you, that's not Christ-like. We should have got a whip together and whipped those money changers right out of the house of God. We should have beat them until they couldn't. They were ashamed to come back. We should have shamed them with the Holy Ghost that lives on the inside of us. The devil's not ashamed now. He parades down streets. Hallelujah. Takes off his clothes and wraps himself in leather and does whatever he wants to right on the street. We have Christ haters, Christian killers, and Jew killers that pray in the streets of this country. Can I tell you something? God's not pleased with us sitting back and saying, oh, let's join hands and help, hope something good comes out of this. God wants you to stand up. Walk right out there. In the next prayer meeting you see in the street, raise your hands up and prophesy to them. Yeah. Hallelujah. Raise your hand and start praising Jesus. Yeah. Let's see what freedom has done in this country. Yeah. See if you still got freedom to praise the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Right in front of them. Right back at you. Hallelujah. While you're praying to that dead rock over there in Mecca, I'm praying to a living Christ, a living Savior that is still alive right now. I wish somebody would say amen. You've received the Holy Ghost. You're full. You're fully grown in God. Don't let the devil fool you. And sorry, everybody listen carefully. Don't let all these faith teachers tell you you don't have faith. I've never seen anything like it. I go listen to some faith teachers and I get discouraged after I hear them because they talk about great faith and living so holy that ain't nobody lives like that. Hallelujah. The preacher saying that doesn't live that good as what he says. I wish we did, but I'm going to tell you the only good thing about me, everybody look at me, the only good thing about me is Jesus Christ living on the inside of me. You need to say amen. And when you forget that, you start thinking you're good and start thinking you're somebody and start thinking you have a lot of faith, God will let you come down a long way. Hallelujah. To prove to you that there's a God in heaven that reigns over the affairs of man, who looks in and he sees and he knows. He knows your heart. He knows how to lift you up. He knows how to answer for you. He knows how to move for you. Amen, church. Hallelujah. You've received the Holy Ghost. I got to tell you right now, you've already been chastened. You got the Holy Ghost in you. Stop worrying about how much faith you don't have. It's the faith teachers that taught you how to doubt. They say, well, here's what to do in case you didn't get a miracle. Who told you you weren't going to get a miracle? Amen. Here's what to do in case your faith didn't, your prayer wasn't answered. What are they talking about? I'm not here to tell you your prayer's not going to get answered. I'm here to tell you that God is going to answer your prayer. Come on, church, say amen here. I'm not going to tell you why you didn't get your miracle. It's because you ain't good enough. You wasn't holy enough. You didn't know enough Bible. You haven't been fasting enough. You haven't been praying enough. I'm sick and tired of those worthless excuses. I don't have to pray as much as I have the Holy Ghost inside me. The Holy Ghost prays in me. Hallelujah. I don't worry about having enough faith. You want to know why? The Holy Ghost is my faith in me. Hallelujah. Faith lives right here. Faith lives in a man. After Jesus got through saying, "Behold, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me," all eyes were fixed on him. You know what he did? He closed the book. You know why? That book, hallelujah, that book was here. Some of you think that you only got the Word of God when you're carrying this book with you. Can I tell you, you ought to close that book. You ought to open this book up. Hallelujah. You ought to let the living Word that lives on the inside of you step forth and heal the sick and cast out the devils and raise the dead. It's living on the inside of you right now. Somebody lift your hand up and say, praise God. Listen, to get the Holy Ghost inside me, I've already been chastened. Yes. Hallelujah. To get the Holy Ghost on the inside of me, I have already been tried. Yes. To get the Holy Ghost inside me, I've already been crushed down. Yes. I've already died spiritually. Yes. I've already gone into the water. Hallelujah. I was buried with Christ. I'm already dead in Christ. Hallelujah. But when he raised me up, he filled me with the Holy Ghost, and that with a mighty burning fire. And sometimes it's just like fire. Shut up in my bones. Y'all ain't gonna say no amen here. You've been lied to and believed the lie. Hallelujah. I was already rejected. The world had already rejected me. Huh. My wife and I were talking, well, I wish I could get on TV in Detroit. That's why nobody knows I'm. I wish I could get on radio here in Detroit. She said, well, they don't want you on there. And I said, I know that. They don't want me on there. You want to know why? I pray for the sick. Yes. Not only do I pray for the sick, I have people testifying that they got healed. Yes. Oh, my God. It's all right to have faith now, Brother Austin, teach on faith, but just don't let somebody come up here and start saying they've been healed by the power of God when you prayed for them. Don't have them saying that. Hallelujah. Because I asked one preacher out here, no, not a preacher, he's a station manager, said he went to ORU and he straightened them out. Said now they don't deal in all that faith healing anymore. And I said, that's probably why your daughter's still sick. Huh, you don't believe in faith healing anymore? Well, that's why they didn't want me on there, because I'm a faith healer. That's what they categorize me as. Huh? My faith never healed anybody, but God's faith does. Hallelujah. Jesus said, thy faith hath made thee whole, but he was saying that to a man then. Jesus don't say to me, my faith makes me whole. I don't use my faith. You remember, I buried it in baptism. My faith died. Can anybody say amen? My gifts and my power and my spirit, it all died in the ground. It was buried in baptism. When I came forth, I came out a new creature. Old things were passed away. All things become new. Didn't matter how much talent I used to have, God ain't going to use that talent no more. God's going to give you a new talent. Hallelujah. He's going to give you new ability. He's going to give you new power. I grew up poor. And the poorest part of the United States of America is not in the ghetto. It's in eastern Kentucky in the Appalachians. You don't have to tell me about it. I mean, you can look it up, the statistics. Perry, Leslie, and Clay County, Kentucky, are the poorest parts, counties, three counties in the United States of America. Can I tell you, that's where I was born. That's where I came from. But the news is, I didn't stay poor. Amen. I didn't stay there. Come on, you can come out of anything you're in right now, and God can bless you. You say, well, Brother Ross, I was born poor. Yeah, you was born poor. You don't have to stay poor. Hallelujah. You could have been born sick. I was. Hallelujah. But Jesus healed me. I was born in trouble, but God brought me out. I was born in the poorest part of the United States, but I didn't have to stay there. Hallelujah. No matter where you are right now, you can stand up and become a new creature in Christ Jesus. God can anoint you with a new power. He can lift you up, fill you with the Holy Ghost, save not only your soul, but save your billfold and save your house and save your car. Hallelujah. He can save your refrigerator. I threw that in just for somebody who might be having refrigerator problems. Lady out in Parsons, Kansas was listening to me on the radio. Brother Allen had me preach one day, and I said, all you have to do is point at your need. She pointed, her refrigerator stopped 3 days ago. Amen. And all of her food, she's afraid, she's eating everything she had because she's afraid it's going to spoil. And so she pointed at it, and she said, in the name of Jesus, and the refrigerator started running again. Hallelujah. I declare to you right now, God is able. You're God's rod, and you can roll back the water. You're God's burning bush. You're God's prophet in the lion's den. You can shut the mouths of lions and quench the violence of fire. You can do it because God lives on the inside of you. When God lives on the inside of you, it means one thing, hallelujah, that he has planted his seed on the inside of you. You have God life living in you. God life living in you. You have God's DNA. You're not just in the family of God. God is in your family. Can anybody say amen? God's in my family. God is my father. Jesus is my brother. You say, well, Brother Ross, that's hallelujah. Is that verging on blasphemy? Well, tear up the Bible then, because it's full of things just like I got through saying. I belong to God. Hallelujah. I've been already through all the trouble and all the hell this world can offer to anybody. I've seen my friends die. I saw them die in a foreign country in a war that I was definitely against. I didn't like it at all. And this is not recently. This is back when I was a teenager. I saw all of this happen. I hated it. I hated that young men would die for nothing. Hallelujah. So the lousy, stinking, no good, rich politicians could go ahead and live their filthy, rotten lives in Washington, D.C. No wonder they go there. If they walked around the streets here, they'd be robbed. They'd be the only ones having the money. Come on, church, say amen. You know I'm telling the truth, too. All they did, doesn't matter what party they are, they're all in the same giant conspiracy, and all they want is you to keep on working and keep on sending your money in and letting them live their glorious, glamorous lifestyles while we're suffering here. I got to tell you something, child of God. I've already been through poverty. I know how it works. I know when you're poor that God can send a way to bless you. I know that when there's no money in the land, God has a way of blessing his people. God has a ram in the bush. Hallelujah. God has God will provide. God will make a way where there is no way. God will open up the windows of heaven and rain it down on you. Well, what about your neighborhood? If they serve in God, hallelujah, they'll get what you get. Hallelujah. If they're not serving God, let them go to the devil and find out what the devil's going to give them. Y'all ain't saying no amen here today. I'm telling you right now, my God is able. My God can put food on my table. My God can put water in my spigot. My God can put light in my house. My God can put gas in my car. Hallelujah. My God can make a way. My God can heal me before I get to the doctor. Hallelujah. Just like you're going to hear Renee talk about here. Hallelujah. We prayed in 2010. The doctor don't even know how she was walking around all these years. Hallelujah. How was she doing it? Hallelujah. It's like the bumblebee can fly and its wings ain't big enough for its body.
mighty, but it don't know it. It just goes ahead and flies anyway because God put it here to fly. Hallelujah. You go to that flower, then fly over there to that flower. Hallelujah. God has his own ways of doing something. God knew this before creation came. God knew it already. God knew how to make a way. Hallelujah. I'm telling you right now, stop looking for others. Start looking for Jesus. Stop looking for a new voice. Get back to the old voice. Stop looking for a new way of saying it. Get back to what the Holy Bible says. Hallelujah. We have to get into the Word of God now more than ever before. Hallelujah. Jesus preached a word that is eternal. He said, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. They are spirit and they are life. They are spirit and they are life. Jesus is not going to talk just to your head. He's going to talk to the man that lives on the inside of you. He wants to talk in here. He wants to move in here. Listen, when he puts his faith in you, it'll show up in the way you walk. When he puts his word on the inside of you, it'll show up in the way you talk. When he puts his word on the inside of you, it'll show up in the clothes you wear. It'll show up in the jewelry you put on. It'll show up in your driveway. It'll show up in your house. It'll show up in your garage. Hallelujah. When Jesus puts his word on the inside of you, power from the Holy Ghost will come down on the inside of you and let the devil beware. Get out of my way, Satan. Get behind me, Satan. Devil, get away from my door, because all power in heaven and earth has been given unto me.
Well, you know, Jesus said that, and they said, well, Lord, you sure all power? Huh? Them disciples is just like these preachers today. They ain't no different. Well, Brother Ross, I had some theologians. I was at a dinner with them and got sick while I was there. I don't think it was anything in the food either. But I got sick there because I was telling them Jesus had all power. That means the devil has no power. And they said to me, but Brother Ross, dear Brother Ross, you know the devil has power. I said, who told you the devil has power? Well, you know he does. I said, who told you that? Was it Jesus told you that, or did the devil tell you that? I know I ain't getting many amens on this, huh? Because you wouldn't know how to serve God if you didn't have a devil. Come on, say amen. Hallelujah. You wouldn't even be in church if you wasn't afraid of hell. Come on, say amen. Most people wouldn't be. Oh, there's a hell to shun and a heaven to gain. Well, that's beautiful rhetoric, but I'm going to tell you right now, I ain't worried about hell at all. Come on, say amen. I ain't even worried about the devil. Huh? The devil's already tried to kill me 3 or 4 times. He always missed. Never did work. His plans always fell through. You want to know why? It's because greater is he who is in me than he who is in this world. Y'all ain't going to talk to me. I'm talking to you about faith here today. Believing in God. I'm a child of the King. You are too. Don't let the devil overcome you. Yeah, the devil wants to come along and say, well, I'm just not all that educated, and I didn't go to school like others, and I ain't got no money, and I ain't been here, and I haven't traveled. Stop giving God excuses. If God gave you the anointing, he already knows who you are. If God gave you the Holy Ghost, he already knows how much education you have. If God gave you the Holy Ghost, he knows your family tree. Come on, say amen. If God gave you the Holy Ghost, he knows where you come from. He knows the highest grade you got in school, if you went. Hallelujah. God knows who you are. God knows all about you. When you walked in here, Jesus already knew everything about you. Can anybody say amen to that? He's not guessing. He doesn't have to send some. Oh, Jesus, I was just interviewing this lady back here. Jesus, now, she told me that she had this condition. God already knows what your condition is. He knew when you came in here. Hallelujah. You don't have to pre-interview anybody. Come on, church, say amen. God seems to always use the most unlikely people. Is anybody saying amen? The word, the most unlikely one. He uses the littlest one in the whole family. He uses the youngest one in the whole family. He uses one don't even have a sword and don't even have any shield and don't even have any weapons of war.
He uses the one that has a slingshot. Hallelujah. Come on, church, say amen. You know why he used David? It's because David had killed the lion and he'd killed the bear, and he's not afraid of no uncircumcised Philistine. Y'all ain't saying no amen. My Bible tells me not many wise are chosen and not many educated are chosen. Not many disputers and debaters with mankind. Not many mighty people with power are chosen. Not many noble of high birth have been chosen. Not many rich and not many famous. Now the world chooses famous people. I can't tell you the number of times I got bumped off of TV programs. Oh, well, we got this movie star coming in. Oh, okay. What do they know? I wish everybody look at me right now. Rap singers are stupid. Country music singers ain't got no sense. They're out there just making as much money as they can. Movie stars, rich people in New York City. What makes them rich? They don't know anything about. They may know how to cheat people with their money. That don't mean that they know God. You gotta search hard and long to find a movie star that is serving Jesus Christ. And so why are you spending your money going out to see people that hate God, hate Christ, don't believe in Jesus, and think you're a moron because you believe in speaking in tongues? Huh? Why you go out here and listen to these edumacators who all they want to do is tell you that we came from a monkey, came from a small one-cell creature, and the world's warming up and it's global warming and we're destroying the whole world, and don't cut down the tree. And while they're flying around in their jet airplane telling you not to drive your car, hallelujah, eating all the lobster and all the steak all over the world while telling you you got to eat something dead that's dried out and put water on and it'll come back to life again. Sad. That's why God don't choose them. You want to know why? They already know everything. God can't tell them anything. Huh? They come out and try to figure out how I heal the sick. Los Angeles, I had people come out there and they said, here, Reverend Collette, just lay your hand on this piece of glass here that's hooked up to this computer over here. And I said, why? They said, we want to measure the power that's coming out of your hand. I said, you can do that? They said, yeah. And I said, well, won't you wait just a little while until I'm praying for the sick and then run down here with that and let me lay my hand on it. And they said, well, yeah, that's an even better idea. I came out there and laid my hand on that thing and the computer stopped working. They said, wait a minute. Well, I plugged it. They did it again and then came back again. And I laid my hand on it and the computer stopped working again. They said, well, we must have made a mistake here. I said, yeah, he sure did. You did make a mistake. I said, you can't measure God's power. Amen. Come on, say amen. You want to know why? There ain't no limit to God's power. Hallelujah. You can't measure how much God is. And, you know, I got preachers doing the same thing. I got church members doing the same thing. Well, he has more God than that preacher does. I'm going to tell you, he has more power than that one. Are you listening to what you're saying here? I'm going to tell you right now, church, you either got God or you ain't got God. Can somebody said, Brother Ross, will you pray that I get more of God? And I said, well, sure. How much you got and how much you want? How much God do you have and how much do you want? I'll pray. That'd be $1,000, please. Say, Brother Ross, you charge them $1,000. I said, if they're crazy enough to think it comes that way, I'm crazy enough to go ahead and get the money from them. Come on, say amen. Well, they didn't and I didn't, so they walked away disappointed because they were looking for the budget revival. Come on, say amen. If it's $20, it ain't worth a prophecy for me. Come on, say amen. I don't give out $20. If you're going to come and ask me for a word of God, you better bring your bank account. Hallelujah. Ha! You thought I was fooling, didn't you? The thing is, child of God, ain't nobody. I can't give you a word of God unless God moves on me. This ain't for sale. All right. I wish somebody'd say amen. Huh? You think you can buy this good thing with money? I'm talking about the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Come on, church, say amen here. God has chosen weak people. Weak people. How many weak people are in here? You think you're weak right now. God chooses weak people. Huh? I used to like that one program that said they're not crazy. They're just merely foolish. Hallelujah. God has chosen foolish people. Huh? God's chosen the shy. God's chosen the timid. He's chosen stutterers. He's chosen the faint-hearted. He's chosen people too young. He's always chosen people too old. He's chosen the outcast. He's chosen those things that are base and despised. That's what God chooses to use. God chose the moon-worshipping Abraham, because he was a moon worshiper from the same place, worshiping the same God that another group is worshiping. They're worshiping the moon. That's why they're getting rid of, coming to the end of their month-long moon worship right now. Abraham was in that cult. And so God brought him out and said, if you'll go, I'm going to send you. So God can use a pagan. God can use somebody that served another God other than him. He'll bring him out. But you know what God said to him? Come out from among them and be ye separate and go into a land that I will show you. It's a land flowing with milk and honey, and my prosperity and my blessing will be upon you. And he sent him to a strange land. And God said in Genesis 12, come out from among them. If you want the blessing of God, get out from this world. Get out from these false religions and get into the power of God. Jacob, whose name meant thief, he chose him to inherit the kingdom of God. Joseph, a lowly slave in prison, God chose him to deliver his people. Moses was an aborted baby. Didn't think about that, did you? They waited till he was born and then threw him in the river. Come on, you talk about a late-term abortion. Huh? They put him out there for the crocodiles. Anybody ever seen a Nile crocodile? I have. I saw one 25 feet long one day. A zebra go running through there and just reached up out of the water and grabbed him and drug him out. A zebra, a horse. That's how big it was. And they put him out there. No wonder he came up slow to speech. He was a stammerer, a stutterer. And then he turned into a murderer. And then God turned around and said, that's a man I can use. Y'all ain't gonna say no amen. You thought you had to be good. You don't have to be good in the past life. After God touches you, that's when you become good. Come on, say amen. The old song I used to sing, I came to Jesus as I was. Hallelujah. I didn't fix to go to church. I came like I was. Hallelujah. And Jesus saved me. Moses was the first to break all the Ten Commandments. Moses broke every one of them before they were written. After they were written, he didn't. Hallelujah. But God doesn't always look for somebody that knows how to talk. Look at me. Good God. If you'd have met me when I first began, you probably wouldn't even understand me, because I did not talk Kentucky. I talked hillbilly. I had to go to school. I had to learn some stuff. Hallelujah. Didn't you have to? Huh? Only you and your mommy could understand you when you was young. You had to go to school. Come on, say amen. You don't have to stay where you began. You go from there, and God can make you to anything he wants you to be. God chose Gideon, who was hiding in a little valley, and he was so skeptical that it was an angel from God that he put out a fleece and didn't believe the angel of God that appeared to him. I know people right now praying for angels to appear to them. If an angel appeared to you, you wouldn't believe them. Well, I'm going to put out a fleece and see if that's right. I'm going to try to prove it. Some of you don't know angels when you see them anyhow. We had an angel last week walk right through this church and talk to people and then turned around and left. Nobody knew it. You know why? Because it looked like a person. God said he would make people, some have entertained angels unaware. Does anybody see what I'm saying here? God can use anything that he wants to. God doesn't always look for the eloquent people. Gideon was hiding in a valley, and the angel came up to him. He's hiding now. He's hiding because he doesn't want his crop to be stolen by the tax man. And he's there, he's reaping, and he's looking at the mountains around him so that they won't sneak up on him while he's reaping his crop, while he's trying to glean out of the food that he's raised. And then all of a sudden, an angel appears there and says, "Gideon, thou mighty man of valor." And he's like, who are you talking to me? Me? You're calling me a man of valor? I'm hiding here in the valley so nobody can find me. You're calling me a mighty man of valor? Listen, I'm going to tell you, God doesn't always look for the one that wants to be used. Sometimes God looks for the one that nobody thinks can be used. Hallelujah. If you got all kinds of talent and ability, and you good looking and pretty like me, hallelujah, and you turn out to be something, child of God, nobody's going to give God glory for it. They're going to say, "Oh, well, he was always smart. She was always the most beautiful. She was always this." But when you ain't nothing, hallelujah, and you come from nothing, and you 5 foot nothing, hallelujah, like me, hallelujah, and you didn't have the best of everything in this life, when God calls somebody like that and heals them when they thought they were dying, and raises them up, and sends them forth to preach around the world, God will do that, because God is looking for somebody who will look to him as their source of power and not look to themselves as their source of power. Samson was an adulterer. He was a fornicator. And God used him to deliver Israel. He couldn't have been the smartest guy in the world. I guess that's why they always, when they have somebody play him in the movies, this is Samson, they always find somebody that's not all that smart. Hallelujah. Samson wasn't all that smart. He was strong when God's power was on him, but that's the only time. He didn't have any sense any other time. Hallelujah. You know he didn't have any sense because where he laid his head. Ruth came from a foreign country who worshipped idols, and she became an ancestor of Jesus. Esther was a courtesan. You know what that is? That's somebody that the king walks through and says, her and her and her, and then he goes to bed. That's what she was. But he'd wound up marrying. She was there for that purpose, but she wound up marrying the king, and because of her, we still have Judaism on the face of this earth. Eli was a drunken priest who fathered Samuel the prophet. You and I need to know something right now. It doesn't matter what you were. It only matters what you are in Christ right now. And if God has chosen to put his anointing on the inside of you, forget the past today and start anew. Start anew in the power of the Holy Ghost. And God is going to use his people. I'm looking right now, hallelujah, I'm looking right now for a move of God that's going to transform this world. There's a man a few years ago who said, "I'm going to fundamentally change America." And he set about it, hallelujah. I'm going to tell you somebody that's going to fundamentally change the world. Hallelujah. His name is Jesus. And Jesus is looking for a man, and Jesus is looking for a woman right now who's going to stand up and say, "I'm going to live for God. I'm not afraid of the fire. I'm not afraid of the lion's den. And I'm not going to bow down to that statue of the king. Instead, I'm going to serve God and live for God and believe in God and hold on to his hand. And angel, when you come and talk to me, I'm going to write it down and put it in a book so future generations will know that I have been with God and I have seen God and I have been anointed by the power of God." That's what I want to do. I want to be here when God dumps out this full, fresh, new anointing upon this world. Not some falling down, laughing revival. I want something that has power on the inside. It's all right to laugh, but when you get through laughing, heal the sick and cast out devils. Hallelujah. I'm not ashamed of the moving of God, of falling out in the spirit and rolling on the floor. I am, by the way, a holy roller. Hallelujah. I believe it with all my heart that God can knock you down and take all the pride out of you so he can use you and make you over into what he wants you to be. Can somebody say amen? God will do that in our life. Revival's coming. Not some goofiness. I said revival is coming. You're going to see it come sweeping down Gratiot Avenue. I don't know if it's coming from the south or the north. It may start here and go both ways, but God's going to have a move of God in this city. There's going to be people anointed. God is going to use you. Who? Me? Yes, you. God is going to fill you with the Holy Ghost. You're going to go walking through the mall one day, If there's one open, hallelujah, still open around here, you'll go walking through the mall and you'll see somebody sick and reach out and say, "Can I pray for you?" And when you pray for them, they'll go running and jumping and leaping, saying, "Somebody touch me. Who was that man? Who was that woman that prayed for me?" You'll go visit Aunt Hattie in the hospital. And when you get there, the anointing of God will come on you, and you'll clean out the whole fourth floor. Hallelujah. Everybody you lay hands on will be healed. Hallelujah. I'm looking for it. I'm looking for that anointing. I'm looking for you to walk into a bank somewhere and say, "We don't know what we're doing anymore. We can't figure out anything." What do you do? "Well, I'm just a child of God." "Well, here's the keys. You can have the whole thing." You say, "That can't happen." Oh, it's happened before. It's happened in history before. God can do the same thing for us. We need a few banks. We need a hotel. I need Mr. Hilton to move over and take his family and go somewhere else and give me a hotel downtown here. Come on, say amen. I'll fill it up. You know who I'll fill it up with? I won't fill it up with no rich peoples. Peoples with credit cards. I'd open it up for people that ain't got no home. Oh, Brother Ross, you can't do that. That's a whole different can of worms. You're not prepared. You're not equipped to do that. I'll tell you what breaks my heart. See these old people out here going, 10 and 11 of them a day, go through the same trash cans looking for a can and some so they can cash it in. And you say, "Oh, Brother Ross, they'd just buy drugs with it. They'd just buy alcohol." What are they going to do? What are you going to do when you get old, Brother Ross? I'm going to tell you something. I ain't going to depend on nobody to do anything for me. I believe in Jesus Christ. I never was accepted anyway. I've only been accepted at a few colleges. And they wanted me to leave before I got through. Come on, say amen. You need to understand something. You're peculiar. The reason you're peculiar is not because you act funny when you pray. The reason you're peculiar is because in this world full of sin and corruption and thieves and lying and perverse appetite and lack of morals, you stand as a pillar for God. Living a holy life. Believing in a God who is able. Join hands with somebody right now. Hallelujah. As I leave this program today, I ask you sincerely, click on the contact page and get in contact with me. I ask you to send a donation. Use your credit card, your PayPal, we take all credit cards you can think of. They're all on there. And I ask you to do that in the name of Jesus and help us stay alive and doing what God calls us to do. Give me your prayer needs. I will pray for you. Order one of my books on faith. Order one of my books online and let me get it to you. Bill's told me that we can now download books. So order it. Get it right now. Read it today. Go back through the past few months or weeks and look at programs that have already been uploaded on my page here. And when you do that, we believe that God will bless you and lead you into a greater truth and greater knowledge. But I need your faithful support. I'm doing this because God has enabled me to do it. Thank you so much.